Well, everybody, please have a seat. Make yourself comfortable this morning. It is so good of all you to come out. Thanks for being here right now, and I hope you had a wonderful Christmas. It's great to have you back with us right now. And I want to begin by saying this morning, Happy Sunday! How many of you feel like you're excited to be in church this morning? Let me see a show of hands. All right. I like to hear that. I like to hear the woo. That's good. And I'll tell you what. Here's what I want you to repeat after me. All right? Ready? Say this phrase. We're going to have fun today. We're going to feel the joy today. All right. Imagine this. Imagine the very first night when they began to feel the joy. The joy of Jesus. The shepherds were out in the fields at night, and they're watching over their flocks, and you can just picture the scene. A group of men sitting around a crackling campfire. Their sheep are in the fields around them. They look like little puffs of cotton in the dark on the fields surrounding them. In the sky over their head, little dots of light, the stars over their heads. And then all of a sudden, suddenly without warning, the sky splits open wide, and radiant light pours out like a waterfall of melting gold. In the center of that golden light, bright, blazing white, are these shining creatures. More than you can count. You're on your knees now. You're kind of shading your eyes, and you hear a voice. A voice deep, resonant, the sound vibrating your rib cage. And they say to you, "Behold, I bring you good news of great joy." And suddenly with those words, the sky is filled with music and with applause and with cheering and with shouting. You see, folks, it was all about joy. Joy to the world. The Lord has come. Joy to the world. And you know what? We need joy in our lives. It's not just something that it would be nice if we had some joy in our life. It would be a good thing to have. You and I have a fundamental need, a psychological need, an emotional need for joy. Without joy, our life is going to feel lackluster. It's going to feel oppressive. It's going to feel overwhelming. But with joy, life becomes awesome, amazing, something that's filled with anticipation. So today I want to help you grab hold of that joy once again. Now, if you're going to be looking for joy, where are you going to find that joy? Well, the Bible says this, I will go to God. I will go to God, the source of all my joy. He is the source. No matter what problems you brought with you when you walked in this place today, you can begin making a positive change in your life today. Start by going to God. In fact, let me give you today three joy builders. Not joy busters, because we all have plenty of joy busters in life, right? Let me give you three joy builders, and we're going to make this simple and powerful, something you're going to be able to remember when you walk out those doors. If somebody says to you, if your kids say to you, what'd you learn in church today? I want it to be so simple, you're going to be able to tell them. And so these three points spell out the word joy. J-O-Y, joy. Whenever you put these three things together, it's gonna produce in you joy. So ready? First one is this. If you really want to have joy in your life, you've got to first of all learn to jettison all regrets about my past. If I want to experience authentic joy, I have to jettison all regrets about my past. Now, jettison means to throw something overboard, to lighten the load, to get rid of something. And the Bible says that if you really want to experience joy in life, there are some things that you've got to get rid of because they're just weighing you down. They're just weighing you down and wearing you out. And the first thing you got to get rid of are all the regrets you have about your past. Because let me tell you something, we all have regrets, right? We've all messed up. Nobody's perfect. We've all got some skeletons in the closet. Reminds me of Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. If you recognize that name, it's because he's the one who created Sherlock Holmes. So Sir Arthur Conan Doyle once decided to play a prank on some of the most famous men in England. So he sent seven very famous men an anonymous note. An anonymous note that said simply, "All is found out. Flee at once." Well, he just wanted to see what would happen. You know what? Within 24 hours, all 8 men had fled the country. They all were worried they were going to be found out. I'm sure we could find out certain things about you that would make you want to flee this church service right now if we knew. Because we all got that stuff in our life. We all got regrets. The only problem with regret is it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You cannot change the past. It can only make you miserable in the present. The Bible says that we just got to learn. We got to just find a way to learn from it and move on. The Bible says, forget what happened in the past and don't dwell on events from long ago. Because I'm going to do something new, God says. I'm going to do something new. In fact, if you're taking notes in your outline right now, just circle those two words, don't dwell. Don't dwell. What does dwell mean? It means to live someplace. And the Bible's saying you don't want to live in the past. In fact, you could write in the margin of your outline, learn, not live. Learn from, not live in. Now listen to me. Everybody's got setbacks. Everybody blows it. Everybody makes a mess of things. Everybody has failures. In fact, failure is the only way you can succeed. You cannot succeed without failure. Why is that? Because that's how you figure out what works and what doesn't work. So, never call it a failure. Call it an education. Now, I understand some of us in this room right now are highly educated people. We're real good at failing, right? If there's a piece of advice I could give you about failure, if I could tell you this as your friend, I would say this. Don't waste your failures. Learn from them. Try something, and if it doesn't work, try something else. The Apostle Paul told us his secret. He said, one thing I do is to forget what is behind me and do my best to reach what is ahead. The starting point of joy is to let go of the past. Jettison all regrets, the grief, the guilt, the grudges. Now you got a clean slate, and the second step is open up to God. Open up to God. Now this is powerful. Let me show you how this can work in somebody's life. Let me tell you about a young man by the name of Ben Hooper. You know, this is years ago, when Ben Hooper was born, boys and girls who didn't know who their daddy was were ostracized. They were treated cruelly, treated as if it was the kid's fault that daddy wasn't in the picture. And by the time little Ben Hooper was 3 years old, he knew there was something different about him. Because he'd go over to a friend's house to play, and the parents would say, what are you doing hanging around with a boy like that for? When he entered first grade, he sat there in his little chair at the little old-fashioned wooden desk, didn't talk to anybody, didn't want to talk to anybody, because nobody else wanted anything to do with him. And as bad as that was, Saturday was the worst day of all for little Ben. Because on Saturday, everybody in town, in that little Tennessee town, would go into shop in the country store. And that's when Ben learned that adults can be just as cruel as children. But then, one day when he was 12 years old, something pivotal occurred. Ben heard about a new preacher who had just moved to town. He heard that he was a really loving man and he really cared a lot about people. So one Sunday, Ben Hooper decided that he would visit church, kind of check it out. Now he had the whole thing worked out in his mind. He did what some of you have done in the past. He showed up late, so he doesn't have to deal with anybody that way, right? Showed up late and he kind of listened to it, checked out what was going on, and he made sure he left early. That way he didn't have to talk to anybody, didn't have to deal with anybody, right? Well, he liked what he heard, so he went back the next week and the next week. Then finally, around the fifth week in a row of being there, he kind of got caught up in the whole thing and forgot to pay attention to the time. Pretty soon, the service was ending and people were filing out, and he's in the middle aisle trying to make his way to the door, and he's crowded with people. And all of a sudden, Ben Hooper feels a hand upon his shoulder. And he turns around and he looks directly into the eyes of the preacher. And that preacher says in his great big booming voice, well, whose boy, his great big booming voice, well, whose boy are you, he said. Well, instantaneously the room went quiet. You could hear a pin drop. You know, you've been in these kind of social situations like this before where it's almost as if by some prearranged signal, everybody gets deathly quiet all at once. That's what happened. And then slowly, Slowly a smile started spreading over the face of that preacher, and it broke out into a great big huge grin, and he said in his great big booming voice, "Oh, I know who you are. The family resemblance is unmistakable." And now everybody's got wide eyes. They're thinking, family resemblance? Who's he going to point to as being the dad here? This is going to be pretty awkward. This is going to be pretty embarrassing. Family resemblance is unmistakable. He points to little Ben Hooper and he says, "You are a child of God." Child of God. The preacher swatted Ben on the backside with his Bible and he said, "That's quite an inheritance you got to live up to, boy. Now go and live up to it." Well, Ben Hooper said, that was the day that his entire life changed. He said, because that was a day the picture changed in his mind. And once the picture changed in his mind, his future changed. In fact, that Ben Hooper, that shy, misfit, awkward little boy, grew up to be elected the governor and re-elected the governor of the state of Tennessee. And he always said it was that day in that church service that morning when he was 12 years old that he really got elected, because he said that's the day the picture changed in his mind. And suddenly he began seeing himself as a child of the Almighty God. My friend, you are a child of God. The resemblance is unmistakable. What does the Bible say about you? How great is the love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. God wants to lavish his love on you. Somebody here today might say, "Oh, I don't think God really cares that much about me. Oh, I don't think God really thinks about me that often." Well, hold on. Look what the Bible says. Even before the world was made, God had already chosen us. In other words, before the stars were hung in their places in the sky, before the mighty mountains were born, before the first human being ever walked this planet, God already knew you and loved you. He already envisioned your future. He envisioned all that you could become. And guess what? He was excited about that. He was excited about your possibilities. Let him lavish all that love on you. You say, but Jeff, you know, I've made such a mess of things. No, you let go of all that. You jettison that past stuff. You open yourself up to God. And the final thing, then yield to God's influence. Yield to his leadership. Someone might say, well, I don't want to get too close to God because, you know, if you get close to God, get all religious, he's going to take away all my fun. Well, do you really think that's true? Do you think if you get close to God, if you really let God be a part of your life, he's really going to take away all your fun in life, all your enjoyment in life? You know what the Bible says? God richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. That's our God talking there. That's his book talking there. For our enjoyment. It also says that Jesus said this, "I have come that you might have life, life in all its fullness." You've been looking for life. You've been looking for the best in life. Jesus is saying, what I want you to have is life. Life in all its richness, all its fullness, all its joy. You see, truth of the matter is, I found that everybody in life basically wants the same thing. Everybody basically wants the same kind of thing out of life. We would like to be what? We'd like to be happy. We would like to be healthy, and we would like to be reasonably prosperous. I know some of you would like to be unreasonably prosperous. That's okay too. Well, listen, remember that you're only going to get that life in all its fullness, all the enjoyment, all the joy, when you consistently yield your life to God, when you open yourself up to all of his blessings and all of his goodness. That's where he's trying to take you. That's where he's trying to lead you. It's kind of like this. I remember reading about Lawrence of Arabia. Have you heard the name Lawrence of Arabia before? Well, back in the 1920s, he took a delegation of Arab Bedouins to Paris for some peace talks. So these guys get there. Now picture this. These Bedouins, these are desert nomads. They travel around on camels. They live in tents, that kind of thing. They get to Paris, and their mind is blown away by all the water everywhere. I mean, it's the opposite of the desert. You go to Paris, the whole city's built on the River Seine. There are fountains everywhere. There are reflecting pools. They get to their hotel room. There's hot and cold running water in all the rooms. Well, they thought it was amazing. They were astounded. 2 weeks later, it came time to go back, and they were supposed to catch a train together. They said, all right, let's all meet in the lobby at 11 o'clock. We'll head out for the train together. It'll take us to our ship. So 11 o'clock comes. Lawrence is in the lobby. He's waiting. None of the other guys show up. Still he's waiting. 10 minutes goes by, 15 minutes. He decides he's going to go upstairs, and he's going to check on those Bedouin men and find out what's going on, why they're late. He gets to their rooms, and guess what he discovers? They're up there busy ripping the faucets out of the sinks, trying to hide the faucets in their luggage, because they figure if they can take the faucet, if they can sneak it back to the desert, they'll have all the water they can possibly desire right there in the desert. They didn't understand how modern plumbing worked. They didn't understand that a faucet by itself won't do any good at all. It's got to be connected to a source of water. Well, here's what I'm telling you today. In the same exact way, human beings must be connected to the source. If we desire all the good things in life, we have to stay connected to the source of all those good things, and that is God. Some of you sometimes feel a bit empty on the inside, and you really can't figure it out because you say, you know what? I got a nice house, I got a nice car. I got a nice job, I got a nice family. But still, sometimes I feel this emptiness, this lack of joy. I feel this deep, I don't know, I could call it a thirst that's never quite quenched. Well, here's what Jesus said. He who believes in me will never be thirsty. Yield to his influence. God alone can quench that thirst in the center of your soul. You want a joy-filled life? Well, here's where you begin. Jettison your regrets. Open up to God, and then yield to his influence. Let's take a couple moments right now just to pray about that before we move on. We bow our heads and we say, Lord Jesus, and that night when you were born, the angels proclaimed, behold, I bring you good news of great joy. Everybody here knows that, look, I'm no angel, Lord, but I hope that's what I did this morning, bring good news of great joy. I hope they felt it, everyone. Hope they soaked it in. And friend, right now Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart. He's knocking on the door of your heart, and only you have the key. He won't force himself in. Question is, will you let him in? Why don't you just talk to him right now in your mind? He will hear your thoughts. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus, I want you to know that I believe in you. I believe that out of love, love too deep to put into words, you came here as a little baby. You came to love me and teach me and show me the way home. I don't understand it all, but today I open my life to you. I yield to your influence and pray, Lord, tell me what to do next to move forward in my life. Right now, you're calling some of us to make a commitment, I don't know, to regular church attendance. We need to be a part of a family of faith, a circle of friends. Or maybe you're calling me to volunteer for something, to join a Bible study, to give something back. Maybe you're challenging me to be more faithful with my time or my money, my personal life. Let me know, Lord, because right now I'm listening. I'm open. I'm willing to yield to your leadership. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And here's a special blessing. Joy to the world, the Lord has come, and he will never leave you. You can be sure of that. Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray together in unison that prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.